Welcome to another Know My Faith Monday podcast. My guest this time is Bryce Turner from Christians for Israel, C4I.
That's us.
That's the modern acronym because everybody does those things nowadays.
Well, it's a lot easier to spell when you're in a hurry anyway.
It is. Right, so tell us about Christians for Israel. What's the brief?
Well, Christians for Israel was founded in Holland just over 40 years ago. By a family who were very passionate about what was taking place in Israel and with the Jewish people. So our brief, which is a little bit different to some of the other organisations, I guess, but obviously overlaps, is to inform, to inspire, and then biblically to comfort the Jews. So the informing and the inspiring part is most of the work aimed mainly at the church.
I was going to say informing Jews or informing Christians?
Informing Christians. Our ministry, our work is actually aimed mainly at the church and at the wider population throughout New Zealand. Our work in terms of comforting the Jews is where we get a chance to support the Jewish community both here, the diaspora around the world, and of course Aliyah is a big focus for us.
Okay, and Aliyah, this is the Jews coming home.
That's right. Aliyah, I believe, is how we translate this idea of going up, yeah. Which is the idea that many Jews increasingly are returning to the Holy Land, which is pretty exciting.
So this is, in some ways, if I use Bridges for Peace as a similar thing, Bridges for Peace are non-evangelistic towards the Jewish people.
That's right.
So Christians for Israel, C4I, is similar?
It is. It's similar. And it's something that, that to be honest, I struggled with a little bit in this role. Let's be honest, we would love it if we were out there lining up our Jewish friends and bringing them to Christ, and if everybody believed exactly the same as I did, well, that would make life a whole lot easier. But that's not what God's called us to do. That's not our mandate. And most importantly, the relationships that we do have with the Jewish community, right through to the Israeli government for some of the projects that our teams are involved with, rely on us having that integrity, I guess, that we're not simply out there to sign people up and convert people. That said, obviously, as Christians, we look forward to the day when our Jewish brothers and sisters do come to the Messiah.
And discover, yeah. But it's in the back of our minds, back of our spirits, I suppose, as Christians, we want to see Jewish people discover their Messiah. And I pull you up on the C word, but we use it all the time. They don't convert, do they? They just come to know their Messiah. And but the problem is through 2,000 years of Christianity, so many. And I was talking to somebody earlier today about Martin Luther. Martin Luther was happy to have Jewish people as long as they converted to Christianity. So in the back of our spirit, obviously that's our heart's desire, but we all play a different part in the body.
That's right.
And the part that you're called to play is not a go and preach the gospel.
I've come to understand, I guess, certainly at this particular part of the work that I'm involved in, that when we look back historically, Martin Luther, as a classic example, was famously, or perhaps infamously, anti-Jewish. Many of his writings, many of the things that he said and did, I don't agree with.
Yeah.
Still a brilliant man, did some wonderful things. We don't deny that, but we have to accept that there were some things there that weren't right. One of our roles is to address similar feelings through the church, through Christians throughout New Zealand and throughout the world. Replacement theology is a major problem.
Yeah.
With, I guess you would say, an arrogance where we have carefully adjusted our theology over time to effectively push the Jews out and make the whole thing, the whole journey about us. And that's not right. No. And from that has come, or certainly that has reinforced, a lot of anti-Semitic, anti-Jewish feeling from Christians who really should know better.
Yes, we should, but I think we are very, very ignorant as Christians of the history that Christianity has with the Jewish. It's in the back of our mind. excuse me, I remember one of the books I narrated for Ariel Ministries is called Israel Betrayed, written by Dr. Andrew Jackson, if I remember correctly. And he goes through 2,000 years of the church deliberately betraying the Jewish people.
Yes.
And it's your eyes open and you go, seriously? We did that? Now, while as the church, and it's very much, I mean, you and I born and bred in New Zealand, how much New Zealand history did you get in school?
I was actually fortunate to have had a bit more than most.
Okay.
But it really was being blessed by teachers who went out of their way to share it.
Right.
So it wasn't
curriculum-wise, we got Abel Tasman, we got Captain Cook, we got Treaty of Waitangi.
A little bit.
That was it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and what people like Robert Considine have shown is that our history was deliberately hidden from us because of what the government did. So what the church has done to the Jewish people has been deliberately hidden from us as Christians so that we're unaware of it, but the Jews are fully aware of it.
Exactly. And that's where, back to the role of Christians for Israel, whilst we are flat out trying to inform and to inspire the church, to our Christian brothers and sisters, to learn some of this history and to have a correct biblical understanding of the place that the Jews have and still must have, and how special they are in God's plans that are still yet to come. Part of informing and educating people is also, I guess, helping rebuild a lot of damaged relationships. And therefore, when we're working with the Jewish community, whom we love dearly, both in Israel and the diaspora and here in New Zealand, there's a lot of work to be done just to reassure them that we're no longer out to kill them.
Yeah.
Because sadly, much to our shame, that has too often been the case over the last 2,000 years.
Yeah.
We've got to fix that first. And so that is the part of the work that we've been called to do at the moment.
If anybody's read Fox's Book of Martyrs, what was done to real Christians by the church or the establishment, Catholic and Protestant, we've got to say.
Yes.
What's missing from there is what the church, Catholic and Protestant, have done to the Jewish people, which would make another Fox's Book of Martyrs even bigger.
Glaringly absent.
You and I were a part of a meeting just recently organised of, I'm not sure how to mention, Israeli-focused or Israeli blessing ministries, at which the new Israeli ambassador was there, the rabbi of the Auckland Hebrew congregation was there. And part of that is to, if I've got it right, because I was the new boy, you know, I was sitting there listening, is just to show the Jewish people that we are there, we are Christians for Israel without the Bible bashing.
It's become loosely known as the Israel Supporters Group.
Yeah.
It's not a formal group. It's not a formal structure. We've all got far too much administration to do in our own jobs to create another one. It's something that was begun by my predecessor, the Reverend Honourable Graham Lee, and a small handful of people. But when I came into this position in 2017, we, the board, and I recognised that this was still a very important a project and something that there was a lot of room to develop. And so we've worked hard to try and grow it. We now have groups from all up and down the countryside, and many are able to make it. Some fly in from around the countryside. Yep. But of course, part of that has been to also grow the relationship with our Jewish brothers and sisters living here in New Zealand.
Yeah, I love the fact that, I mean, I think it was the rabbi's wife who said that she felt so comfortable coming along to that meeting.
And that's what we're about. And I guess it comes back to that mandate that Christians for Israel has, but even wider. Represented amongst the groups there were groups who are working very much in humanitarian. There are some groups who are very much evangelistic and looking to share the gospel with the Jews. There are some focused on Aliyah. There are some focused on matters of justice and law. There's a huge spectrum. But we all agree that one of the most important roles that we can have together is to support the Jewish community, especially when, again, much to our shame, From time to time, there are things being done in our own country and by our own country.
Yeah, it was that interesting really that, that resolution came up again, and that's a few years old now, but yeah, most New Zealanders will have forgotten completely about the it was 132 or whatever the number was.
4332.
4332.
Yes, another great black mark in the history of our country.
Most Kiwis will have forgotten about that completely, but the Jewish Kiwis haven't.
No, no. And again, this is part of the informing, part of the inspiring, is New Zealanders need to realise how much damage that did. They need to realise that politically, in the international spectrum, New Zealand is not looking very supportive of Israel and of the Jewish people at large.
Yeah.
And we need to fix that as a group of Christians and supporters of Israel and the Jewish people in New Zealand. We've got a lot of work to do. And from time to time, hence gatherings like the Israel Supporters Group to encourage projects and working together where there's actually quite a lot of us.
Yeah.
Many, many tens of thousands represented by the various different groups. There are occasions where we need to stand up and speak and from time to time speak out against our own government.
And not just our own government, but at times our own people. In one of our upcoming podcasts, where I'm talking with Perry Trotter, who runs evangelicalzionism.org, I think, or .com, and when it happens, it'll be in the notes. But what he talks about is evangelical anti-Zionism.
That's right.
Which is just a continuation of this Israel betrayed. I think what happens is a lot of people think if you are pro-Israel, you're anti-Palestinian.
We run into that all the time, and it is not helpful.
No, and it's not true.
It's not true. The Palestinian situation is very complicated. It's very sad, and it's very real. But I think one of the things we need to be very open about is that absolutely, unequivocally, we support Israel's right to exist. Absolutely, we support the Jewish people, and we recognize the fact that they're getting a hard time. There is huge anti-Jewish and anti-Israeli feeling all around the world. But at the same time, there's a group of people, the Palestinians, who are stuck. They're being used to some degree as political pawns. They're living in an environment and in a way that is not pleasant. And we can't ignore that. The difference is whether we simply say, well, that's Israel's fault, Israel caused it, Israel has to fix it.
Yeah.
Clearly, I don't believe that. But at the same time, it doesn't change the fact that these are human beings who are having a hard time, and we have a responsibility to them. Our organisation obviously is clearly focused on Israel and on the Jewish people, but we also support several projects throughout the areas controlled by the Palestinian Authority.
With different ministries, if you use Tear Fund and World Vision just as examples, one of the things World Vision say, which is similar to Christians for Israel, is when they go into it. They're a Christian organization. They want to spread the gospel. Mm-hmm. But if they go into an Islamic country, which World Vision are allowed to get into, or into communist countries, where the governments go, we don't want you to talk about Jesus, World Vision will go, okay, let us come in and feed your children and help you and do these things.
Mm.
Tear Fund, or Compassion, on the other hand, go, no, that's a non-negotiable with us. So Tear Fund don't get into some of the countries that World Vision get into.
Mm-hmm.
But we're all part of the body. We're all, you know, there are Christian organizations whose main focus are the Palestinian people.
Yes.
You're not one of them. You're one whose main focus is Israel.
That's correct. Unashamedly.
Yeah. Yeah, which again doesn't say we're anti-Palestine.
No, definitely not. And it's been my privilege to have visited Israel on 4 occasions. I'm not sure if we can count the 4th one. As soon as COVID had just hit and we weren't allowed off the airplane.
You didn't visit Israel. You visited Ben Gurion's landing
strip. Well, we ate Israeli-made food sitting on the tarmac in Tel Aviv. But the previous.
So you stayed in the place, you went like all the way back to, is it Hong Kong or Singapore?
Korea.
For Korea.
Seoul, Korea.
So, which is 10 hours?
About 12 or 13 hours.
So you went from Korea, from Seoul to Ben Gurion,
And back to Seoul.
So 20
changed aircraft.
20 and almost 24 hours on the plane.
Three back to back flights. It was quite something. Just as an aside, I'm glad that I was travelling with a bunch of New Zealanders. There were 25, 26 of us on a whole plane load of people from all over the world. And New Zealanders do stand out.
Oh, we do, don't we?
We're a pretty relaxed, laid-back sort of people, even when there's a major crisis going on.
One of the accusations thrown against pro-Israel groups and ministries is that we believe Israel can do no wrong.
We hear that a lot. The fact is that Israel is a democratic and sovereign nation. And insofar as I'm a fiercely proud New Zealander, I have been here, or my family have, for quite a number of generations now, and I back my country to the hilt, especially when we're playing Australia.
Yep.
But the fact is, it's not perfect. And any organisation, whether it's a country, it's a democracy, it's a church, as soon as you have a group of people from different backgrounds with slightly different interpretations, different life experiences, they're not always going to get it right all the time. And the fact is, Israel doesn't always get it right. They make some decisions from time to time that I don't think are the best. But it's their right to make them.
Mm.
And that's more the issue that we're supporting. As a sovereign nation, as a democratic nation, as a nation that should be free to determine its own political course,
now,
they're going to make mistakes.
And this is from a political point of view, not just from a spiritual point of view.
That's right.
So I know Pastor Nigel Woodley from Flaxmere Christian Fellowship. So Nigel, when he does his supporting of Israel,
mm-hmm.
which you may have seen some of his full-page advertisements in the New Zealand Herald and in the Dominion Post. Mm-hmm. He's doing it from a Christian perspective.
Yes.
The Bible says this, this, and this about the Jewish people and the land. However, they have a internationally, legally mandated right
mm-hmm.
to be in the land. The United Nations said, that's the land of Israel. So Ben Gurion stood up, said, boom, here we are, we're a nation. So while we support them as the Jewish people back in their traditional homeland,
mm-hmm.
as Christians, even without that, they have a right to be there.
Absolutely they do. And what's important to note, and I'm sure it's come up with other guests, is that the determination to re-establish the Jewish homeland vastly preceded the United Nations.
Hmm.
That goes all the way back to the Balfour Declaration in the vacuum, the political vacuum that was created after World War One.
Yeah, with the Ottoman
conclusion
Empire
of the Ottoman Empire.
Yeah.
Everything had come apart at the seams, and what was the League of Nations at the time sat down and came up with a plan. The mandates of the League of Nations were all unequivocally accepted and transferred to the United Nations post-Second World War. But I think some people are of the misunderstanding that the United Nations created Israel, whereas, in fact, the nation of Israel has been there in various forms for an awful long time,
yes.
thousands of years. And even the modern state of Israel, the precursors to it, the foundations for it, were established right back in the First World War. At which New Zealanders played a significant
major part. Yes, and we celebrated that just a few years ago. Mm. Like me, you travel around the country, speak in different churches and different groups. So, twofold question: number one, how hard is it to actually find churches that are willing to listen to your message? All right, and secondly, I feel like Parkinson now with questions like that. The reaction once they've heard the message that you give them, the how often do you see the eyes opening? They go, oh, I'm so glad we actually asked you to come along because we had no idea.
That's a good couple of questions.
Yeah. So how hard is it to find a church or a group that will go, yes, we want to listen to you?
It is very difficult. One of the things that we're very fortunate with is that people talk. And so often if you can go into a church or into a group, a special interest group, whatever it happens to be in the Christian community, and give it everything you've got, do as the best job you possibly can, often from that people will connect you with somewhere else.
Yep.
And to be honest, that's where most of our connections come from. To ask a pastor to hand over his pulpit on a Sunday morning, having been a pastor,
yep.
I understand that there is a mantle of responsibility and there is some caution. I understand that the topic of Israel, be it politically modern Israel, historical Israel, or of course the biblical focus, which is what we should be starting with, is contentious in some circles. But at the same time, there are some brave pastors, yeah. some brave church leaders, and so when an invitation is extended, we will quite happily travel the country if necessary to go and present this message.
Yeah, it's people get scared that, you know, that when you turn up, because I find this as well. You're going to turn up with a Bible and a prayer shawl and a circumcision knife. Yeah, and it's like, no, that's the furthest, the Bible, yes.
But doesn't that just highlight how important it is?
The ignorance, yes. It highlights the ignorance that's out there.
Absolutely.
And how important it is. So the second part of the question is, once you've given your talk and the reaction from people that get, that it's like, I had no idea.
We're very fortunate in that, hopefully, if we do the job well.
Yeah.
Mostly the response is exactly that. People come up and say, I just had no idea. And the fact is that if you read the Bible, I know there's people that spend their entire lives trying to reinterpret and adjust it and twist things in order to suit the convenient narrative, and this is not the only issue in which Christians do that, of course. But the fact is, for most people, if you open the Bible and read it for yourself, God will reveal in there that this is what he's doing. This is the place of the nation of Israel and of the Jews. And most importantly, that there's still a lot of stuff to come. That his plans for the end of times, which directly affect us, and I'm just a Gentile. It's exciting to see that those plans, which directly affect me and my eternity, still involve the nation of Israel and the Jews. And of course, we can see these things coming to fruition right now.
Yeah.
There's always, in a group of Christians, those one or two people that you make a few comments and you do your message and then you duck for cover to see what's going to be thrown.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm afraid I've come to just appreciate that, you know, if there's one or two folk that are especially challenged by the message, bless them.
Yes.
I'm more than happy to sit down over a cup of coffee and discuss it and bring about the very best of my knowledge and experience, such that it is so far and it's still growing every day.
Yeah.
But, you know, one of the other things that we're missing in our society, I think, and it's a topic for another whole discussion, but it's also reflected amongst Christianity and amongst the church, is we've lost the ability to sit down and discuss a point, a perspective, and even if we disagree, still part on respectful terms.
You know, it's amazing you say that. A friend of mine, Kobus van Rooyen, who's a South African pastor, retired pastor now, but he came to pastor the Baptist church in town, and he, like, after about a month, he comes to see me. He's not quite in tears, but he's going, Rob, what is going on? He says, if I preach something in South Africa, if I preach something and somebody doesn't like what I preach, they will come and see me after the service and say, Pastor, I will be in your office at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning.
Mm-hmm.
He says, if I do that in New Zealand, I just never see the person again.
That's right.
They just leave. You're right. We've lost the ability to sit down. Mm. I'm sure if you and I sat down over enough coffees, we'd find something that we could disagree on.
Oh, guarantee it.
You know?
We'd make something.
Yeah, but the maturity is to still, you know, that's not a salvation issue.
It's but not.
To me, and this is the thing, and again, and I'm sure the listeners and viewers will get sick of me saying it, but the problem that I see with the modern church is that because we've been taught that Christianity involves me believing in Jesus, and that's it. I don't need to do anything,
mm-hmm.
right? I can simply sit there on Sunday morning singing Shout to the Lord and wait for the second coming. Because what you're telling me about Israel is not a salvation issue, Bryce. I believe in Jesus, so I'm going to heaven. It's not a salvation issue for you, but you aren't the point. You know, let me ask, is heaven better than earth, or is earth better than heaven?
Well, I'm looking forward to heaven.
Okay, so if God wanted the best for Bryce Turner, the moment you became a Christian, he would have killed you. And you would have gone to heaven. So here's my next question.
It's an interesting discussion.
Did he kill you when you became a Christian?
Not yet.
So he's not leaving you here for your sake?
No.
And that's the thing. No. It's not a salvation issue for your sake. It's a salvation issue for somebody else's sake.
That's right. We've got a job to do.
Yeah. And we really need to know the scriptures in depth to be able to be able to get that across. And instead of just sitting there Sunday morning going, you know, rapture.
But therein lies the problem. How many Christians know their Bibles? How many Christians are able to pick it up and discuss and debate and share and learn based on an in-depth knowledge of God's Word? And what really frustrates me, my senior pastor during my first pastorate when I was a young fella challenged me. If you're going to have an opinion, if you're going to get up and thump the pulpit and put some weight to that opinion, you absolutely must be able to back it up.
Yeah.
If you don't know what you're talking about, shut up. And you know what? I've really come to appreciate that. I certainly didn't at the time, but I've really come to appreciate that. And that's part of the challenge. If people want to come and share an opinion that's different to mine, no problem. Let's sit down and have a chat. But please be able to back up where you got that opinion from and where that information can be found.
If you disagree with me on a theological issue and you can show me from the Bible why you disagree with me, I'm happy with that and I'm happy to disagree with you.
Absolutely.
If you disagree with me basically because you disagree with what the Bible says from my without coming up with your own argument from the Bible, I don't have time for that.
It's going to be a short coffee.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, well, I don't think God, I don't feel God, I don't, you know, there's no place for think or feel in theology.
But that's right. You've hit it right on the button. And I would contend, and again, like anybody in Christian ministry, I guess, I'm only sharing from the journey that God's led me on. This is not a case of having sat down and had an epiphany one day and all of a sudden had my theology 100%.
Yeah, you had the Bible downloaded 100%.
Unfortunately, yeah. Haven't worked out how to do that yet. So my experience, my interpretation of God's Word is based on my own journey and is based, well, to be honest, on a lot of mistakes and having to learn from them. But nevertheless, that's the journey God's taken me on.
Yep.
But what I'm finding more and more, and I'm more and more convinced of, and more challenged in my own life, is that where these problems seem to come from is a reversion right back to the beginning of time to that original sin of pride, of believing that we know better than God, believing that my position is somehow more right and more proper and more correct than your position.
Yep.
And it's even further than that. Because as soon as my pride, as soon as my belief in my own self-importance becomes out of place, that immediately means that if you believe differently to me, I can't respect you. You're not as deserving. Right. And that is simply based on pride. And to be honest, it's an arrogance. And it's something I am continuously challenged to work on,
yep.
To keep humble, to keep open. But it's something I just see all around me. In our society as a whole, to be honest, but in the church, yeah. Amongst Christian brothers and sisters, again, who should know better?
I was accused the other day of being arrogant in my position. Oh, I think I'm reasonably arrogant. Get to know me enough, you'll find out. But because I disagreed with my friend's theology on a particular topic, all right? So he's a disciple of a certain Bible teacher. And he said, yeah, Rob, you're so arrogant. I mean, this guy's got a double degree, this, that, and the other thing, and you think Rob Holding in New Zealand knows better. I go, no, you misunderstand me. You are following his line of teaching. I am following a different line of teaching from other double degree theological professors. You know, it's not that I'm disagreeing with it. It's that the teachers I listen to, I mean, that's a biblical thing. The rabbis, that's why you have the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Herodians and the whatever. But as long as we can still sit down and agree that whether it's hokey pokey, orange choc chip or goody goody gumdrops, it's still ice cream.
It's still delicious.
Yeah, it is. Hey, Bryce, thank you so much for your time. The newspaper.
Israel and Christians Today.
Yeah. So we're going to put a link there. That's a free newspaper?
It is. You can sign up on our website. You can contact our office.
But sign up doesn't mean...
We'd love to send it to you.
Sign up doesn't mean I sign up for everything that you agree with.
No. Nope.
It just means sign up to get
no,
the newspaper.
No, in fact, we're very blessed. Quite a number of the Jewish community in New Zealand have subscribed to the paper. Clearly, they don't agree with everything that we have, but they like to see what we're up to, and I guess they like to see that we support them. And so there's many tens of thousands of copies now that go out either in print or via the internet. The same core paper is used by other affiliates around the world, English-speaking affiliates. It's a wonderful tool, and if it's of value to anybody, they're very, very welcome. We'd love to send it to them.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.